Good morning and welcome as we celebrate this Holy Eucharist, and we are delighted to welcome those who are joining us online. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hidden. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Pray. O God, your Son made himself known to his disciples in the breaking of bread. Open the eyes of our faith, that we may see him in his redeeming work, who is alive and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated, minister of the word.
A reading from the book of Acts. Peter addressed the people. You Israelites, why do you wonder at this? Or why do you stare at us as though by our own power or piety we had made this man walk? The God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, the God of our ancestors, has glorified his servant Jesus, whom you handed over and rejected in the presence of Pilate, though he had decided to release him. But you rejected the Holy and Righteous One and asked to have a murderer given to you, and you killed the author of life whom God raised from the dead. To this we are witnesses. And by faith in his name itself has made this man strong, whom you see and know. And the faith that is through Jesus has given him this perfect health in the presence of all of you. And now, friends, I know that you acted in ignorance, as did also your rulers. In this way, God fulfilled what he had foretold through all the prophets, that his Messiah would suffer. Repent, therefore, and turn to God, so that your sins may be wiped out. The word of the Lord.
The Lord does wonders. Answer me when I call, O God, defender of my cause. You set me free when I am hard-pressed. Have mercy on me and hear my prayer. You mortals, how long will you dishonor my glory? How long will you worship dumb idols and run after false gods? The Lord does wonders for the faithful. Know that the Lord does wonders for the faithful. When I call upon the Lord, he will hear me. Tremble then and do not sin. Speak to your heart in silence upon your bed. The Lord does wonders for the faithful. Offer the appointed sacrifices. Put your trust in the Lord. Many are saying, oh, that we might see better times. Lift up the light of your countenance upon us, O Lord. The Lord does wonders for the put gladness in my heart, more than when grain and wine and oil increase. I lie down in peace, at once I fall asleep. For only you, Lord, make me dwell in safety. The Lord does wonders for the
A reading from the first letter of John. We have declared to you, whoops, I'm sorry, wrong one. Again, it's a reading from the first letter of John. See what love the Father has given us, that we should be called children of God, and that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Beloved, we are God's children now. What we will be, he has not yet revealed. What we do know is this: when he is revealed, we will be like him, for we will see him as he is. And all who have this hope in him purify themselves, just as he is pure. Everyone who commits sins is guilty of lawlessness. Sin is lawlessness. You know that he was revealed to take away sins, and him there is no sin. No one who abides in him sins. No one who sins has either seen him or known him. Little children, let no one deceive. Everyone who does what is right is righteous, just as he is righteous. The word of our Lord.
Amen. why do doubt arise in your hearts? Look at my hands and my feet. See that it is I, myself. Touch me and see. For a ghost does not have flesh and bones, as you see, I have. And when he said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. While in their joy they were disbelieving and still wondering, he said to them, have you anything here to eat? They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate it in their presence. Then he said to them, these are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled. Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures, and he said to them, thus it is written that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. The Gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Liberating and life-giving God, Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer. Amen. I want to read the closing lines to our gospel reading for today, and to invite us to think about that not only as we reflect, but maybe through the day. Think about, what does this really mean for each of us as a believer? Each of us as people of a resurrected community, the Jesus movement, the people of God, the church, the body of Christ, however we may call ourselves. Then he, Jesus, opened their minds to understand the scriptures. And he said to them, thus it is written that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name for all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. You know the saying, seeing is believing? But sometimes that's not always true for many of us. Sometimes even though we see, we cannot believe what we are looking at, what we are seeing. Because it is so surprising, so overwhelming. You just can't wrap your head around, am I really seeing well? Do I need to go and see my eye doctor? Seeing is believing. But believing is not just a heady thing. And that's the important point to keep in our hearts and minds. Believing is being able to see and to own that which is before us as being real, as being true, as being very much what it is that is before us. Our gospel reading today at least the verses for our gospel reading, is preceded by a number of things. The disciples they've heard that Jesus is alive. Jesus appears to first a woman and instructed her to go tell. Jesus then meets up with two disciples on the road to Emmaus. And we're told in that story, they rush to tell the other disciples, "We've seen the Lord." So the knowledge of the resurrected Christ had become known to the close followers of Jesus. They had heard it. And then in today's gospel, we are told that Jesus just appeared in their presence. And they were afraid. And our Lord's first words to them, as our Lord's first words to each of us in our own hearts when we are afraid, "Peace be with you. Peace be with you." They could not make out, what is this? This person before us, this person who looks like the one whom we had walked and talked and prayed with. They couldn't believe their eyes that Jesus was standing in the midst of them. They were startled and terrified. And Jesus kind of asked, "But why are you? I'm sure you've heard. I'm sure you've been told that I'm alive. I've risen from the dead." And then he said to them, "Look, see my hands and my feet. I am not a ghost. I'm the real thing. I'm the real deal. I'm the real McCoy. It is I, Jesus of Nazareth, your master and friend, the one who broke bread with you, the one who walked with you, the one who journeyed life's path with all of its ups and downs and trials." And then he said to them, "Touch me." Now, interestingly, in an earlier account, we know that when Mary saw the risen Lord, in one account, she wanted to grab him. "Touch me not." But now he appears to his disciples and he said, "If you don't believe, touch me. It is I, flesh and bones." And we are told he showed them proof, evidence, that this was no ghost. This was a living being in their presence. And even though they were happy, they were still wondering. They were still uncertain. So maybe our Lord said, "Okay, I've come among you. You've seen me in the flesh. I tell you and showed you my hands and feet. And you still seem to have doubts. Give me something to eat." Do ghosts eat? Do you know of any ghosts who eat? Our Lord was making every effort to help them come to understand that Scripture was being fulfilled, that he would suffer a cruel death, but 3 days after he will rise from the dead. And that rising will usher in a new beginning, a new era, an era of hope, an era like that that has never been known. And we are told they gave him broiled fish, and he took it and ate in their presence. And then Jesus thought it important to continue to help them to understand what his being risen was about, what it would mean, not just for them, but for years to come, generations to come. And he brought them back to the scriptures. He said to them, remember the scriptures of the law, the scriptures of the prophets, the scriptures of the Psalms. And as you heard in today's psalm, the wrestling that the psalmist always had in that relationship with God. Just as the wrestling that I'm sure each of us has in our trying to make sense out of what does it mean to say I believe? What it means to say I trust God? What it means when we are promised healing and hope, being restored? And my friends, that's a lifelong struggle. And it's okay, let's not beat up on ourselves when we struggle at times with our faith or relationship with God, trying to understand God's intent and purpose, especially when we think of the contradictions of life, the difficulties and trials of life. When we think of the things that just doesn't make sense in a broken and confusing and at times despondent world. But the risen Christ sought to reassure his friends, it is I. It is I, the one who has been among you and the one who has come now to usher in new life, hope. Hope for a better world. Hope for healing. Hope for new life. And just as he suggested to them the importance of looking to Scripture, so Scripture doesn't exist all by itself out there. Hebrew Scriptures and New Testament Scriptures are for us to constantly renew and remind ourselves of what we call the salvation history, our salvation history, what God has been doing from the beginning of time. In Genesis, we are told that when God created all, he looked on it and he said, wow, this is very good. A reminder to us that what God has made is good. What God has made is lovely. What God has made is intended for harmony and good living. And even when ugly things happen, disappointing things happen, we still need to be reminded that God sees God's creation as good. And our willingness to renew our faith in the goodness of God and be contributors to the goodness of God by how we live, by how we behave. And they were also reminded that the prophets had prophesied that the Messiah will one day come and he will walk among you and he will do wonderful things. And for the wonderful things that he will do and say, he will be falsely accused, crucified, buried. But death would not have the last word, because he is the God of the living, not of the dead. He's the God of hope, not despair. He's the God of healing. He's the God who every day wants to do a new thing in your life, in my life, and in the life of the world. But we live in reality, my friends. We live in the reality that we are, as a world, a broken people. A world where we doubt. A world where we have our trials. A world where even when we're seeing God's goodness before us, it is too good to be true. And hence, your need and my need and the need of all believers to daily renew that faith and confidence in Jesus Christ, despite all that may be happening around us. For the resurrected Christ and the hope we have in him, the healing we believe he brings, does not mean the absence of illness or the absence of trial or the absence of failure. What it does mean is that we have got to keep hoping. Hoping in the one who has promised, I am with you. And I know that's hard for many of people who find themselves in extremely difficult circumstances. I mean, how are our brothers and sisters in Gaza feeling at this moment? How are people in many other parts of the world where cruelty is all that they experience around them? How are people who are feel broken because of bad relationships, loss, the inclination would be to doubt. But for over 2,000 years, the witness of the risen Christ has always been there. And that is your witness and my witness to carry on. That Jesus lives. He lives in spite of all that may seek to make us fearful, all that may seek to make us doubt, all that may want to lead us to not believing. And Job is a wonderful reminder that despite losing everything, property and family and all that he had, Job earnestly believed in God and God's presence. I know that my Redeemer lives. And that must be our hope. That must be what we believe in, even in the trials and tribulations and challenges of this life. And it begins with two things. It begins first and foremost with repentance. Our need to acknowledge our own failings, our own sins, our own shortcomings. And the faith that he can and does forgive. Because of his resurrection, we are called to renew our lives every day. Whenever we open our eyes to renew our faith in him, Lord, I believe. Help my unbelief. Help me with my struggles. Help me with what isn't making sense in this seemingly wicked world. But this is still God's world. This is still God's creation. We are still God's creatures. And God loves us unconditionally. And as church, as a faith community, we can witness what we as a church done through the years have been through the ministries that have been exercised in the name of Jesus. Not in the name of the church, in the name of Jesus. In our first reading, when Peter healed that man and people were amazed, he said, it's not me, it's God. It's the power of God that has brought about that healing. And that's what we need to remember. It's the power of God that can change and transform and make a difference. And it is in that power that we believe, that power of love, that power of healing, that power of forgiveness, that power of renewal. And as church, that's the story that we must tell. We must tell the story of the unconditional love that God continues to pour out upon all flesh. We must continue to talk about our faith. to talk about the little miracles in our lives. The miracles that we experience in little ways, and to bear that witness to others, both believers and unbelievers. And so today I invite us to be challenged by this gospel story that Christ is alive. He is a risen Christ. He is a Christ who has come among us that we might have life, that we might have healing, that we might have hope, that we might have forgiveness. And receiving such, bear witness. Tell that story. Tell that story not just with our lips, but how we live. Because we're told in Scripture, they will know that you are my disciples. They will know that you follow me, you believe in me, you follow Scriptures by how you live, by loving one another, even your enemy. You are the witnesses. So church, let's leave today accepting the command, the challenge to be witnesses. To be witnesses of God's eternal love, of God's eternal presence in our lives, of God's promise in his Son, Jesus Christ. I go to prepare a place for you, and I will come again, and I will receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. We are the people of the resurrected community. We are the people of the Jesus movement. We are the people of God, the body of Christ. One Lord, one faith, one baptism. That's who we are. Let's live that today and always. Amen. I invite you to stand as you're able. Let us confess the faith of our baptism as we say, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son of God. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The prayers of the people.
The prayers of the people can be found on page 122. In joy and hope, let us pray to the source of all life, saying, hear us, Lord of glory.
Hear us, Lord of glory.
That our risen Savior may fill us with the joy of his holy and life-giving resurrection. Let us pray to the Lord.
Hear us, Lord of glory.
In the worldwide Anglican Communion, we pray for the Anglican Church in Aotearoa, New Zealand, and Polynesia, for the Primate, the Most Reverend Philip Richardson, the Most Reverend Sion Utupila, and the Most Reverend Don Tamili. In our own diocesan prayer cycle, we pray for the Eglinton Deanery. For our parish family members, we pray for Diane and Kirk Herter, Chris Mackey Hillhouse and Todd Hillhouse, and for Joan and Jim Hodder. We pray for the Congregation of St. Mark's Orangeville, for Randall Shea and the Santa Maria School. In the world, we pray for the long-lasting and peaceful resolution of the conflict between Israel and the Palestine, and for the people of Lebanon and Syria. For the restoration of peace and security in Haiti. For those who are experiencing the unrest in Sudan. For Ukraine, for its people and leaders, and we pray for peace. For the people of Afghanistan and Iran, we especially pray for the women and girls whose rights are being denied by their government. For all victims of violence, for truth and reconciliation, for all refugees and asylum seekers, we pray for the unhoused, that isolated and persecuted churches may find fresh strength in the Easter gospel. Let us pray to the Lord. That he may grant us humility to be subject to one another in Christian love. Let us pray to the Lord. That he may provide for those who lack food, work, or shelter. Let us pray to the Lord. That by his power, war and famine may cease through all the earth. Let us pray to the Lord. That he may reveal the light of his presence to the sick, especially remembering those Betty Cartwright, Audrey Lees, Logan McCaughey, Taylor Small, Donna and Chuck Davies, Aaron McCarthy, King Charles III, for Pat Russo, Debbie White, Shirley Barnes, for Ron Coles, John Porter, the Honorable John McDermott, Boris Pujak, Catherine, Princess of Wales, John Hall, Christopher Frankham, Norma Hamilton, Eric Copeland, for Marie, the Vandershot family, for Glennis McQuay, and any other known to you aloud or in your heart.
For Judy, for Dan, for Julie, for Colin, for Christopher.
We pray for the weak and the dying. We pray for those who have died, for Peter Rhodes. We remember Nora and her family today, that they may be comforted and strengthened. Let us pray to the Lord. That he may send the fire of the Holy Spirit upon his people, that we may bear faithful witness to his resurrection. Let us pray to the Lord. Amen.
Dear friends in Christ, God is steadfast in love and infinite in mercy. God welcomes sinners and invites them to this table. Let us confess our sins, confident in God's forgiveness. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal through Jesus, and build up our common life. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Away our sins in water. You give us new birth by the Spirit and redeemed us in the blood of Christ. As we celebrate the resurrection, renew your gift of life within us. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ, the risen Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Blessed are you, gracious God, creator of heaven and earth. We give you thanks and praise for the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. For he is the true Paschal Lamb, who has taken away the sin of the world. By his death, he destroyed death. And by his rising to life again, he has won for us eternal life. Therefore, joining our voices with the whole company of heaven, we sing our joyful hymn of praise to proclaim the glory of your name. To you, Lord our God, for the goodness and love you've made known to us in creation, in calling Israel to be your people, in your word spoken through the prophets, and above all in the word made flesh, Jesus your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him, you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him, you brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, a death he freely accepted, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it, and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, Father, according to his command, we remember his death, we proclaim his resurrection, we await his coming in glory, and we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we made acceptable in him may be sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, reconcile all things in Christ and make them new, and bring us to that city of light where you dwell with all your sons and daughters. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation, by whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
Amen. As our Savior taught us, let us pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come.
Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins,
as we forgive those who sin against us.
And deliver
us from evil. The kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Lord, we died with you on the cross.
Now we are raised to new life.
We were buried in your tomb.
Now we share your resurrection.
Live in us, that we may live in you. The gifts of God for you, the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. Author of life divine, in the breaking of bread we know the risen Lord. Feed us always in these mysteries, that we may show your glory to all the world. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Glory to God, whose power working in us. Glory to God from generation to generation in the church. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord cause his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you and give you peace. And the blessing of God Almighty, Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer, come down on you and remain with you and all whom you love here and in eternity, this day and forevermore. Amen.